Okay, it's such a blessing to hear the kids, and you know, they come back and they remember like, oh, this really fun game or whatever, but the truth is God just ministers to them and they come back completely different. God, you know, pours things into them that we might not see come to pass what that is for 10 years, but he puts things in them and he ministers to them. And so it's so exciting to see them go to camp and come back with the fire of God. Welcome. We have no visitors to welcome necessarily, so welcome. Okay. Let's go ahead and pray, and I'm going to get started because we've already had a pretty good time this morning, haven't we? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you and we praise you. We lift you high in this place. Lord, I pray that your anointing and your presence would be upon every heart here, Lord, that you would reveal yourself mightily through this word. Lord, I pray that your anointing would be upon me, that my words would be your words and not my own. And I just pray, Lord, that your will would be done in this place today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so quickly, we're going to just recap a little bit so that we can boogie on. This week is High Above It All, Part 3. This is Part 3. And so the first one was all about how we are seated with Christ, and we live from a place of being seated up here. We always try to live and act like we're down here, but we actually are up here with Christ. We're in the heavenlies with him. It doesn't seem as though we are because people think he's like way up there floating around somewhere. No, he's right here sitting next to you in the room. And so we talked about that, and we talked about how the snakes are dead. Anybody notice you have any dead snakes? Whoop. I like dead snakes. And it's really, really cool because yesterday morning I was out on my prayer drive and I was driving and there was like a dead snake. Another one. It was like mangled all over the road. And I was like, amen. Confirmation. The snakes are dead. They ain't just dead. They're dead. Amen. Amen for the dead snakes. And then we talked about how do we stay above it all? How do we stay above it all? And we talked about the foundation of the inheritance of what we have on earth that's been given to us through the Holy Spirit, which are the fruits of the Spirit. And so that's our foundation, is that we have an inheritance that we can live in this moment. We don't have to wait till we die and our rich uncle gives us $1 million. You know, our inheritance is now. Our inheritance is in this moment. We're already living in our inheritance. But what comes with that inheritance can be work. Anyone attest to that? It ain't easy to live in this inheritance sometimes, right? Just like we talked about the hope of heaven, it can be hard to keep the hope of heaven, which is our inheritance. So the main point today is head to the top of the mountain. If you're taking notes, head to the top of the mountain. You're going to understand what this means here in just a minute. So today is all about you. Last week was staying above, and what does that mean? What has God provided down here? Now today is actually walking out the inheritance. This is going to be part 3. Next week is part 4, and I'm going to take you through all the fruits of the Spirit. And usually when you start talking to people, especially if you've been in church for a while, about the fruits of the Spirit, people get all scared. Patience? Why? When? Where? No. Just shoot me. No, I'm just kidding. I don't want to have patience. Who here battles with that? Okay, just so you know, lying, not lying is not a fruit of the Spirit, but you guys are lying. I'm just saying. Come on, y'all have patience. You all have trouble with patience. So here's the thing. There's a lot of things in the fruit of the Spirit that scare us, that are like, man, can I really walk that out? Can I really do that? You can, but it takes a lifetime. It takes a whole lifetime. And so we're going to learn about that today. And I think some of you, I'm on Facebook Live, And this will be recorded. So those of you that watch this later or listen to it later, just know, I know you ain't here because you are fruit. Just kidding. You're like, oh no, I don't even want to be told again about this fruit because I know that I am not walking it out. Just kidding. I don't know if you are or you're not. Only you guys can be the judge of that and the Lord in your life. So what does it mean by heading to the top of the mountain? What mountain, first of all, like what mountain are we headed to the top of? We're headed to the top of the mountain that is the Lord's. And what's so interesting is as the Lord spoke to me for this message today, he said, there is a mountain. He told me to go to Isaiah 2, and he said, there is a mountain of the Lord that was prophesied. Isaiah prophesied it for the latter days. Now listen to this. And he said, tell my people today, if they're going to walk in the fruit, that this is what the fruit is. This is what the fruit is. It's not just love and joy and peace and this whole list that we know we got. Okay, the 9 gifts, the 9 fruits, you know, it's not. There's something that takes us there, and we learn it as we head to the top of the mountain. And he said, you tell them, as they head to the top of my mountain, that's where the fruit is grown. That's where they grow the most, is when they head to the top of the mountain. And so listen to this. Isaiah prophesied this, and then you're going to start connecting the dots with what was spoken to you last week. Isaiah 2 through 5 says, it shall come to pass in the latter days, which is now, today's latter days, that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be lifted up above the hills, and all the nations shall flow to it. And many peoples shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations. He shall decide disputes for many peoples. And they shall beat their swords, this is key, into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Now think about, leave it up there for a few minutes. Leave the scripture up there. Think about this. This is huge, you guys. So the Lord sends me to this verse, and he says, you tell them, it was prophesied exactly what we talked about last week, that Jesus said, it was prophesied that in the latter days, there would be a mountain, and it's the highest mountain. And when you're on the top of that mountain, where are you? You're above it all. You're high above it all. And he said, but the thing is, people don't realize that to get to the top of the mountain, there's a climb. He said, tell my people they have to climb the mountain. That's the fruit. You gain the fruit as you climb. This is part of you walking out your inheritance, is the climb. The climb. Not the song. Talk about that later. It is true, though. It's the climb. It's the climb. And so this is so amazing, because as we go to head up the mountain, here's the thing. Sometimes we just want to quit, right? The mountain gets kind of terrain and steep, so we just kind of stop. Doo-doo-doo-dee-dee-dee. Well, I'll just camp out here for a minute, because that looks like a really far trek to get to the next spot up the mountain. So I'll just camp out here and practice patience for a minute. Here's the thing. No one ever said the climb would be fun. But I'll tell you this, it is fun because it is your inheritance. And I'm telling you this, He was so clear. He said, you tell them to head to the top of the mountain. Come up high with me. If you are walking and you have the fruits of the Spirit, it'll take you your whole life to learn them. It'll take your whole life to learn them. It'll take your whole life to learn the first one. And that's what you're going to learn about today. And I'm just telling you, I'm not going into this telling you, you just better be perfect overnight. You just better walk quick up to the top of the mountain. You just need to be above it all and you just need to get with it. No, it's work, you guys. Heading to the top of the mountain. And think about this. The Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. He has established himself way up. Now you're saying, oh, well, I have to earn my way. No, no, what you're not understanding, it's not about earning. But as you climb, who here knows that the endurance and the effort and the perseverance and the not giving up and everything you have to learn to climb to the top of a mountain? I mean, there are people all over the world that like do it for a living and get people to sponsor them. I climbed to the highest mountain. It's like, actually, dude, you didn't. Because I know where the highest mountain is. And you can't climb it in person. It's inside of you. The mountain that you climb is inside of you. And it is your inheritance. And it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful climb. It doesn't always feel like it. But if it's an amazing, amazing thing. And what's interesting is Isaiah prophesied exactly what I told you last week. Now listen to this. Last week we talked about Joshua, right? Joshua comes in to take his territory, and this is the Old Testament, to take his territory, to take his inheritance, they had to kill with the sword. They had to go cut some heads off, like literally. I mean, even the little children. God said, take them all out. Take the land. This is your inheritance. They went in with swords. But listen to this in this prophetic verse. Is it still up there? They shall beat their swords into plowshares. Listen to this, you guys. Let it sink in. This is your inheritance. Do not let this word today pass by your heart. Their swords into plowshares. What's a plowshare? What does that do? What's a plowshare do? Somebody yell it out. It's what? It's to farm the land, right? To till it up, to prepare it for seed. When you plant seed, what happens? Something grows, and then what happens? You get some fruit, or maybe some vegetables, but, you know, let's just say fruit today. You know, we all want to avoid the vegetable. Just kidding, I like vegetables. So here's the thing. Isaiah prophesies that in this latter day, the work will be done not through the sword, like Joshua went. I mean, literally, he went in and just cut off their heads. Like, watch, like, what's the one movie? Yes, Braveheart, okay? That was Joshua. Like, for real. He was just like, ah! You know? I know, I'm doing that terribly. I'm sorry. That was, like, totally girly. I don't even know what to tell you. I could have someone come up and do it for me, but okay. Here's the thing. Sorry, guys. Am I totally ruining the Braveheart look now? You're like, I can't even think of him the same now. With makeup and frizzy hair and get all psycho, okay? Here's the thing. We still have to be brave, and we still have to have a heart. But now we are not coming in with the sword. And so this is so huge, you guys, because a plowshare comes in to prepare the ground for growth. This is huge. Let this sink in today. This is huge. And he was already prophesying this, that this was going to be a part of being at the mountain on the top with the Lord. You are going to be plowing. Then he goes on to say, and their spears into pruning hooks. Get this, you guys. I wish I could like made it really good and plain, more plain for you. But those of you that know anything about farming or land or anything, you know where I'm going with this. You know very clear what I'm saying. So here they had swords in the Old Testament. They went in and just killed people, brave heart, rah, take the land. But in the New Testament, we plow. We plant seed. Stuff grows. Hopefully good fruit. But then the pruning hooks come. Not spears. The pruning hooks come. And the Lord goes clippity, clip, 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 clip. So now here's Isaiah prophesying that in Jesus' time, our life, heaven on earth, living above and staying above it all, is going to look like our fruit. Think of this. Let it sink into your heart. The fruit that we grow in is what is to remain and what is the mountain of the Lord. And when he showed me this, I was like, Lord, you are totally giving me way too many books. I've got some books to write. I got to get busy, y'all. So the thing is, this is huge. Really think about this. It's much bigger than just walking in the fruit of the Spirit. It's much bigger than that. Isaiah had already spoken that how heaven would work in our lives would be the fruit of the Spirit. Because you're not going to prune and plow up the ground just to go murder somebody. And so now God uses the fruit and the growth and the pruning. The pruning is not fun, and we know that. But this is huge, you guys. This is how you become more fruitful. And he said, tell them to get to the top of the mountain. Just head there. Just get started. He said, some people, they don't even want to start, which is the first fruit. And we're going to go into that here in just a second. But he said, to stay above it all and to walk in your inheritance. Your inheritance is the fruit. So when you die and your kids all get together and they read your will, guess what it's going to say? I left to Johnny the fruit of love. I left to Billy. Sorry, Billy. The fruit of long suffering. Sorry. Okay. I could just pick out 9 of you, but I don't want to torture you all. But you get where I'm going with it? So here's the thing. Your kid would be like, what? What? The fruit of love? What the heck is that? Precisely. The fruit of love. That's what your mommy and daddy in the Spirit are leaving you as a legacy of the fruits of the Spirit. It is our inheritance. It is our inheritance. Now, as I take you through this, you're going to think about times that you were not fruitful at all. And you're going to get a glory bomb. And you're going to be like, ah. Every now and then, you guys have to be a little sassy. So I know that there's going to be a few times throughout this thing that you're going to have a Reba moment. Anyone know who Reba McEntire is? Anyone ever watch her show? Hilarium, I'm telling you. Hilarium, okay? She's a Christian on this show, and she does not promote drinking or anything like that, but every now and then she would say, this calls for some liquor, okay? But every now and then, when she knew it was what it was, this was her famous saying, and if anybody who watched the show will know what I'm saying, it is so true. This was like, at least she went every show, at least said this once. Crap. So you're going to have a little bit of that throughout this. But it's going to be glory bombs, okay? It's going to be glory bombs. And I'll tell you, Reba said it well. She said it well. And yes, I said the crap word in church. Sorry, Facebook Live, if I'm offending anybody on Facebook Live. But here's the thing. Throughout this message, you're going to have some, Reba moments. Just please don't ask for liquor, because we ain't got any. I mean, ever. We got grape juice. We'll give you grape juice. Okay? So here's the thing. The fruit is our inheritance. What is the fruit? We're going to move along and boogie on through this. We're going to go over love and joy today, and we're just going to breeze right in. But the Lord needed me to help you to understand that the mountain of the Lord, if you are with him and you are headed up the mountain, you are staying above it all. Because his mountain is the highest and most established mountain that could ever exist. And so as you head to the top of the mountain, you are staying above it all. And that's your journey. That's your walk. That's your inheritance. That's the fruit being played out in your life. So Galatians 5, 22 through 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, which means patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. So this means there is no limit to how much of this fruit you can produce. No limit. But the thing is, there's a climb involved with gaining this fruit. And the Lord said they have to head up the mountain. They've got to keep on going. They got to not quit. They got to not give up, because the fruit is worth it. The fruit that you gain from the climb is worth it. So let's look at it. Love. Love is going to be the first one we're going to talk about if you're taking notes. So basically, we must climb the mountain. We have to head to the top of the mountain. We grow in our inheritance as we climb. So we're going to break this down. Today our focus is love and joy, and so let's talk about the very, very first one. Because here's the thing. The more we walk in the fruit and we practice it, the more light is in our life, and the darkness cannot contend. Just like Christ said in the message last week in his word. If you are full of my light, the darkness cannot contend. It can't comprehend what's going on with you. It can't fight. There is no way when you're in a dark room, when you turn a light on, that darkness can stop the light. It can't. It literally cannot. It is impossible. Unless you come in and you turn the light off or you cover it or whatever, you know. But the darkness itself must be dispelled. And so as you practice the fruit, which these are the hard parts of the message, because you guys just are going to get, you know, reminded of some things. And maybe this is your first time ever learning about the fruit. So the fruit of love. What does love mean? Here's like a world definition, okay? Strong affection for another arising out of kinship or personal ties. The object of attachment, devotion, or admiration. So here's the thing. There's a lot of different types of love. That is a normal definition of love in just the secular world, okay? So basically, by its standards, you only love what you like. Let that sink in. You only love what you like. That's not God's way. The feeling of love isn't just supposed to be produced by strong affection. Love arising. I'm just saying funny. Here's the thing. We always want a feeling to go with it, and that's a lie. That is not biblical. Who here has had to love some unlovely people? Who here has family? Okay, we're going to do a lot of laughing at the end because it's going to be about joy. We're going to see if you can get your giggle on, okay? So here's the thing. If you have family, you've had to learn a lot about loving them when you don't feel like it. That's normal. But here's the thing. Who here knows that the word love gets thrown around really easy? Okay, shout out some things that you love, okay? Like, keep it clean, people, okay? I shouldn't have to say that in church, but, you know, I think we got a rowdy group, so I got to tell you, keep it clean, please. Mexican food. Traveling. Guns. Horses. The beach. What would you say? Dogs? Cooler weather. So here's the thing. It's very easy to throw the word love around, right? I love dark chocolate with almonds. All the guys are like, meh. The women are like, yeah. Here's the thing. It's very easy to throw that word around. And here's what's interesting. Think about all the things you said. They're all connected with pleasure. Climbing the mountain ain't fun, y'all. I'm just keeping it real with you. It isn't always going to be fun to climb. And you're going to stop and you're going to get tired. And you're going to be like, God, I don't know if I can do this. But I'll tell you this, love will take you there. Because here are some things people love: family, spouse, friends, sports, hobbies, food, clothes, different types of drinks. So it's so easy to be like, oh, I love this, okay? Because it gives you pleasure. There are strings attached, right? What happens if one of those family members or friends do something to really irritate you? Are you feeling the love then? So here's the thing. Love, biblical love, is loving even when they're unlovable. And it's choosing to do it God's way. You know what I'm saying? So let's look at what the Bible says. This is basically the chapter on love, 1 Corinthians 13. We're going to do verses 1 through 7 and then verse 13. It says, Paul explains it very well in this. I may be able to speak the languages of human beings and even of angels, but if I have no love, my speech is no more than a noisy gong or a clanging bell. Ever been one of them? Got any gongs, clongs, clings in here? Sorry, I'm having fun with this, you guys. I may have the gift of inspired preaching. I may have all knowledge and understanding, or understand all secrets. I may have all the faith needed to move mountains. But if I have no love, I am nothing. I may give away everything I have and even give up my body to be burned. But if I have no love, this does me no good. Then he goes on to say what love is. Love is patient and kind. It is not jealous. Woo, I see. I got some underline there. Oh, where's the underline? I thought I underlined some. Okay. Patient, I have that underlined. Kind, not jealous, or conceited, or proud. Love is not ill-mannered, or selfish, or irritable. Love does not keep a record of wrongs. Love is not happy with evil, but is happy with the truth. Love never gives up, and its faith, hope, and patience never fail. And then if you move down to 13, meanwhile, these three remain: faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. This is biblical. This is the love that we have to have. It's the first fruit of the Spirit. Now think about this. Isn't it interesting that the first fruit, first of all, is love, and secondly, it encompasses so many things? And then you add the other fruits. Crazy, huh? That's a lot. That's a lot. And so I could literally do a series just on these seven verses. But we are keeping it simple for you today the best we can. Patient. I mean, this is all encompassed. Patient, long-suffering is one of the fruits we will talk about next week. But the thing is, this is all a part of love. being patient and kind, not jealous. Don't be jealous of what other people have. Don't be jealous of what other people have. I will tell you this, and this is a huge one. If you're jealous of what other people have, then it's going to take longer for you to get what God's got for you. It slows down the blessing. Because jealousy is not his fruit. Jealousy is not a fruit. It's a vegetable. I mean, you know, whatever one you hate the most. So here's the thing. Conceited or proud. Love is not ill-mannered. That's a big one, you guys. It's okay. I know y'all are having some really big Reba moments right now. Selfish or irritable. So here's what I'm going to tell you. No matter how much faith you have, no matter how much hope you have in the Lord Jesus Christ, if it's never produced in your life, flowing out with love, it means nothing. It literally, you actually cancel all of it out if you do not have the love, the first thing on the list. And you know why he makes it the first thing? Because I'll tell you this, he told me as I was preparing the message, he said, if they do not have love, the love that encompasses all these things, does this mean you'll always be like this? Lovely and wonderful. No. This is the real world. You got family. You got kids. You got coworkers. Come on. You got pets. I don't know. Whatever you got, okay? You're going to be irritable every now and then. You're going to get a little annoyed. But here's the thing. When you have love, it's what you have to get going up the mountain. It's the beginning. Love in your heart and in your life, and that being produced, is what's going to keep you going up the mountain. If you have patience and kindness, what can get at you? Really, what can the devil do to you? What can flesh do to me? Nothing. And so what happens is, if everything that tries to hit you can roll off because you're walking in the fruit of love, and you let it roll, what does that look like? Does that mean that you just put up with everything? Nope. Did you ever know that there's a tough thing called tough love? Sometimes that's the best thing you can do for someone, is to just tell them like it is. In love. Okay? Not rudely, but with a calm, peaceful spirit, and in the Lord, you can be real with someone that needs to hear something if they're destroying their life. You guys get where I'm going with that? So here's the thing. This can be really scary. I knew I was going to have to spend the most on love because it encompasses so much. And so here's the thing. If we have love, everything falls into place. We cannot give up and quit partway up the mountain. We have to keep climbing. And if you do not have love in your heart, you can't do it. It's what keeps you going. Okay, here's a good example. Mommy and daddy's in the room. Somebody messed with your kid, what would you do? What'd you say? Kill him? So here's the thing. That's a love. So think about this when you're climbing the mountain of the Lord and you just want to live above it all and you want to have that growth and you're trying to do it. You're like, I'm going to do this, Lord. I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to let my boots get worn out and tired, and I'm not going to, you know, whatever. I'm going to do this. Think about the love that you have for your child. If someone were to come and try to harm your baby. So there's a love that you don't even know exists until someone brings something up against you. If you're sitting there, you don't even know how quickly you could poke someone's eyes out if they mess with your baby. You get all crazy on them. If you weren't crazy, you'll be crazy for about 2 minutes. And so there's a love that's in there that keeps you going. You would, okay, let's put it this way. Let's say your kid was at the top of the mountain and you start at the bottom with this mighty love that's in you that don't get ugly and show up until something's about to happen to your baby. And someone's on the top of the mountain threatening to kill your child. Do you stay at the bottom of the mountain? No. What drives you up the mountain to take out them and become psycho? The love, right? It's the same thing. If we have the love, the fruit of love in us, it will drive us upward to the top of the mountain to stay above it all. It'll drive us up. Just like if someone was wanting to hurt your baby, there's a love in you that will not stand for it. Now think about this. What if you get to a really steep part of the hill and you can't figure your way out to get to the next step? Do you quit? Nuh-uh. You will get up there and you will save your baby, right? You will save your child. Nothing will stop you. Because that love in you drives you to never give up. It drives you to never give up. So here's the thing. That's not an example. That's not a parenting tip. So don't take it like that. I got to do everything for my children. No, that's not. That's a different kind of love, okay? That's a different kind of love. So here's the thing. Sometimes the love looks like what? Holding tight or letting go. It's not always going to have fun feelings with it. It's not always going to have fun feelings with it. So here's the thing. It doesn't matter how good you think you are at, and this is just a list of stuff I added in here. I'm good with money. I'm good with cleaning. I'm very organized. I walk in gifts. I have talents. I have abilities. Good for you. If you don't have love, it means nothing. It doesn't matter how good you think you are as a fleshly human being without the fruit of love. Those talents will only take you so far up the mountain. And then you have to have something deeper inside you to drive you all the way up. Because I'll tell you, we go through junk on this earth. We battle stuff. We get tormented. And the thing is, we have to have that fruit of love in us. It's what keeps us going. It's what keeps us climbing. So basically, when you don't feel like it, be nice. When you don't feel like it, be friendly. When you don't feel like it, shut up. I see some faces with that one. What? I don't want to shut up. Here's the thing. Here's what I'll tell you. What does love look like? Well, here's what it looks like. How do you know if you're not walking in love? Really? Well, how will I know? Well, if you want to gouge out their eyes, you're probably not walking in love. If you're wanting to scream and yell at them and slap them all around, you're probably not walking in love. If you're in your car, I'm going to go there, and you're in really bad traffic, and somebody cuts you off, and you get a little upset, and a few kind words come out, and maybe even a finger. Hey, it's been done to me. And I didn't even do anything. I've had someone yell and cuss me out and flip me off because I did not leave on the turn lane quick enough. for them. And I wasn't even on my phone or anything. It was just, it literally turned green. Beep, 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 beep. I'm like, geez, relax. You should have left earlier. Why are you beeping at me? The light literally just turned green. How fast do you think I am, you know? Here's the thing. It can be so easy to be in a pattern of living your life reacting, not with kindness, not with gentleness, not with the feeling of love, that you don't even know you're doing it. And so you have to come to a place where you ask God, okay, help me to see when I'm not walking in love. So let's just see. Here's some examples. If somebody rips you off or does something to you, and you immediately, you know, have revengeful thoughts and all that, that's not love. Here's the thing. You have to be okay with what God's done for you and what he hasn't allowed to be done. Does that make sense? And so you have to get to a place where even if what someone's doing is really frustrating you, you don't get frustrated. You have to look deeper than that. And I know it's a lot. It's a lot to learn. It's a lot to have to do. But you have to. So let's say you feel like there's someone in your life who is always doing the wrong thing, according to you. I mean, sometimes they are doing, might be really doing the wrong thing, okay? But according to you, they're doing the wrong thing. Well, instead of getting upset and offended at them and having an attitude every time they do, you feel like they do the wrong thing, you walk with love and gentleness towards them. And how about you take a moment and maybe you be there for them? And you listen to what's going on in their life and you actually shut up. Shut up. And don't automatically think you know everything. And give that person a minute. Because I'm telling you, we've all been through stuff. And you know what? God needs us to be gentle with other people. With the devil? No. Well, my husband is the devil. No. Just saying. What do I do now? Here's the thing. You pray for him. Seriously, you pray for him. That's what you got. Okay? The love of God doesn't flip out. It doesn't want to be angry and violent with people. It doesn't get offended at everything. Love learns how to go back. And we got so many more fruits to do. Patient, kind, not jealous, not conceited or proud, not ill-mannered or selfish or irritable. And here's the thing. Isn't it true that a lot of times our reactions that aren't lovable is because we really just want something to go our way? It's not happening fast enough, right? But here's the thing. If you begin the climb to the top of the mountain and you really begin to pay attention to that fruit working in your life, you are going to notice that you can breeze through so many more things if you just have that fruit working in your life. And then it's not even hard. And literally, and the Lord brought to my mind the song, Hannah Montana, whatever, Miley Cyrus, sorry. I call her Hannah Montana. Who knows her as Hannah Montana? Okay, yeah, okay. But there is one thing she got right before she became Crazy Miley Cyrus, okay, from Hannah Montana. The song is, It's the Climb. Let that sink in. It's the climb. It's the climb that counts. It's not how fast you, and I'm not going to quote all her words, it's not how fast you get there. Patience. We'll learn a lot about that next week. It's not about how fast you get there. It's the climb. And so as I'm preparing the message, the Lord's like, it's the climb. They need to understand that's their inheritance. The climb is your inheritance. It's where you gain the fruit. It's how you figure out who you are. Are you going to have perseverance and build endurance, or are you going to quit? Are you going to get up there to a little ledge and perch? Do-do-do. Just going to take a break. No. It's a climb, and the climb is what gets you to the top of the mountain, but you cannot skip the climb. But as I said earlier, if your child was at the top of that mountain dying and going to be murdered, the love would be so deep in you, the climb would not even matter. The whole time you'd be going up, you wouldn't even be thinking about the climb. You would be maneuvering, you'd be looking, you'd be strategizing. How do I get to the top of the mountain the fastest as I can, right? But the thing is, with our walk with God, a lot of times we just want to perch. Me. Suck down a couple gallons of water. Complain a little bit about the previous climb. You know what so-and-so did to me? And you want to sit and dwell on it for a minute. Here's the thing. The love of God and that fruit being active in your life is your inheritance, and it will keep you going. It will change your life, you guys. It will change your life. Walking in love will change your life. It will change your life. If you don't even consider the selfishness of you, it will change your life. It will change your life. Love is the most important fruit of the Spirit. It's amazing. Learning to love and the ability to love, the ability. You have to learn it. You guys ever see kids when they're little? They're like two. Are they lovey? Are they all lovey-dovey? I mean, maybe when they want a cracker. If the neighbor kid takes their Tonka truck, somebody's going to get the smackdown, right? So here's the thing. Love is our inheritance. We're not born all lovable, you know? We have to learn how to walk in it. And it is your inheritance. And if you see it that way, if you see it that it's worth more than money, the fruits of the Spirit are worth more than money. They're worth more than anything. The value and worth is in what you gain from the climb. It's the climb. It's the climb. It's the climb. I'm going to have Matt go ahead and come on up. So the second one, and this is just short for joy, because it's so interesting that God puts joy right after love. It is the next fruit. So here's the thing. I could sit here all day and tell you examples of what is not, you're not walking in love. I could tell you stories. But the thing is, this is something you have to figure out between you and the Lord. So number two is the joy of the Lord. Joy. Anyone battle with having joy? Here's the thing. Once you have the fruit of love growing in your life, you will have a joy that the devil can't steal. The joy of the Lord is different than the joy in the world. And I only have just a tiny bit on joy. What is joy? The emotion evoked by, listen to this, well-being, success, or good fortune. What if you're not having success? What if you're not having good fortune? The world's joy, and that's the world's definition. What do you do then? If there's nothing to invoke it, how do you have joy then? Because the world's joy is not the same as God's joy. There's a joy that's deep inside of you that God places there. And you know what it is? It's a grateful heart. It's a grateful heart for what he's done for you, that he died, that he has a new life for you, that you have an inheritance. That's the joy that the Lord provides. Nehemiah 8:10. Then he said to them, go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. If you are cultivating the fruit of love, and then joy is second on the list, you can have joy even in the midst of the worst situation. It can be storm all around you, but you're still laughing. You're laughing at the devil. You're laughing. You're laughing. Let me hear a laugh. Laugh. No, like a real one. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Oh, ho. My sister used to go. I can't do it very good because it was natural for her. But my laugh, I'm serious. You do not want to get me going. If I get like seriously going, I'm like, like I get like a. Like, I'm weird, okay, people? That's a deep belly laugh. So here's the thing. Okay. Okay. Okay, Holy Spirit, stop. Stop! Okay. I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. Okay. Here's the thing. Stand up, you guys. Just kidding. Here's the thing. We laugh in the devil's face. When we have the love of God and we're climbing the mountain to the top, because we are going to have our inheritance, and then we choose to have joy because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Anybody ever have a really bad day and then watch something funny? It helps to just laugh. To just laugh. Just laugh. Oh, walk around your house. Oh, and then laugh at yourself. And then say, oh, I cracked myself up. I'm just kidding. So here's the thing. Here's the thing. The joy of the Lord is your strength. The love of God is the fruit that will keep you going so you can do the climb. The climb is where you gain the most, you guys. It's where you gain the most. And if you have the love and the joy of the Lord from his Spirit moving and working in you, nothing the devil brings against you will work. Nothing. He can do nothing. Nothing will destroy you. Nothing will destroy you. Because you have that strength in God. He is your strength. He keeps you going. And what you do is, when you're sitting there feeling like, and you be honest with God, God, I ain't feeling this joy. I ain't got no laugh deep inside me right now. You stop. And you search for that inner gratefulness. For all that he's done for you. When I'm having a bad day, you know what I do? I look back, and I'm not saying torture yourself or anything, but I look back and I think about the life I could have had with my alcoholic mom. I could still be a drug addict. Living on the street, sleeping around with whatever guy would take me in so I'd have somewhere to sleep, provide me with drugs. Think of this, that would be my life. So I look back and I take that one moment and I say, God, you saved my soul. You took me out of the pit. And that pretty much takes care of it for the day. Because I'm so grateful. I go back to that moment where I could still be me. I could still be the old Liberty. Being a fool and just ruining my life because I thought I was worthless. And I didn't have a choice and it wasn't true. There is a love that can be produced in you. There is a joy that you can find even when stuff is so hard. God did not save you for no reason. You matter to Him. You are loved. You are so, so loved. And so before we have a couple of declarations and we're going to be done, I know we went a little longer with all the camp stuff, but Matt's going to lead us for a moment and then we're going to do our declarations and we're going to close up.
Nothing I hold on to. There's 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 nothing I hold on to. And I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. There's nothing I hold on to. 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 And I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. I will climb this mountain with my hands wide open. There's nothing I hold on to. 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 There's nothing I hold on to.
Oh, Lord, we are so grateful, Lord. And we climb this mountain with our hands and our eyes wide open. We thank you, Lord, for the climb. We thank you that the climb is going to lead us to live above it all. God, we thank you. We are so grateful. We are so grateful. Okay, so we're going to repeat some declarations. So I want you to repeat this after me. I declare that I will head up the mountain. I declare I will walk in my inheritance. I declare I will practice the fruit of love. I declare I will choose joy. I declare I am high above it all. I declare I am seated with Christ. Amen. You guys, the climb is so amazing. The climb is so amazing. It's so amazing. Next week, we're going to talk about the rest of the fruits of the Spirit. And I know that it's going to be awesome, whatever the Lord has for you. But just know this. Just climb. Just climb. Just keep going. Don't quit. Don't listen to the lies of the enemy. Just climb. Just climb. Just climb. Just keep going. Just keep going. Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you in this place. We thank you for the fruit of love. We thank you for the fruit of joy. We thank you, Lord, that you provide these two things to walk us through and take us to the top of the mountain. Lord, I pray that the fruit of love would be cultivated in the heart of every person in this room. Lord, I pray that joy would strengthen every person in this room, that they would not judge their joy according to happy things happening, Lord, but they would find their joy in simply knowing that you are their Lord and Savior. Lord, I pray that you would strengthen every person here and that they would leave full of your joy, full of your love, Lord, and full of the hope of heaven. Lord, I thank you and I praise you. I pray a blessing over every person here. Pray that they would be safe as they go. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys are awesome. For those of you staying for Katie's birthday, that stuff's happening in the back there. We love you guys. Have an awesome day.